Our next guest says to ignore the trade war and buy stocks. Ryan Payne is here, president of Payne Capital Management.
Nicole.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you too.
So it's very interesting. Ignore the trade war. What trade war? We should just go out and buy them, especially now after we've had somewhat of a sell-off. This is the worst month of the year, I should say, right?
Yeah, but we had such a fantastic year that this is one of the first pullbacks we've had. And where I come from, you want to buy when stock prices are down, Nicole, not when stock prices are up.
Well, a lot of people would say, you know, you buy the winners, you buy the ones that have some momentum, you buy Disney, you know, it hits a high, you get in there, you don't look around for the losers. And now that we've had, a run up, you still get in there because the momentum. I mean, you're saying a completely different concept.
Well, I mean, buy low, sell high. It's as old as the hills. But I think, you know, when you're looking at building your portfolio and you're looking to put cash to work, you want to buy things that are up because, you know, growth keeps moving here. It's been a growth market and things like Disney keep moving. We have exposure there. But there's a lot of things that haven't worked as well that I have to think are a buying opportunity here. I mean, financials have obviously lagged what tech has done and things like that. So you want to make sure that you spread your money around.
So, I mean, do you like financials? Do you like tech?
I think financials are probably better long-term buy. I mean, I think tech does have the momentum trade, like you mentioned.
Right.
But when you start looking at multiples there, they're starting to get a little rich, depending on what you're looking at.
But some of the tech names, I mean, when you break it down, like semiconductors, the semis have been beaten down. Anything somewhat tariff-related or Huawei-related has had the beatdown recently.
Sure they have. I mean, their multiples are actually cheap, right? I mean, if you look at Amazon, for instance, that trades at about 65 times forward earnings. I mean, that's mm-hmm. on the other side of the spectrum, really, really expensive. So I think, yes, if you're buying the semiconductors here, anything that's been selling off because of the bad news with China, it's probably a good buying opportunity.
Yeah. Do you think a lot of people you hear of like Amazon still? They're still in there?
I think money managers need to keep up with the indexes. So they're going to continue to buy, which means retail investors, because they're in mutual funds, are buying it. It's going to keep propping that up.
Yeah. And like a name like Apple today, you know, had a price target cut, but that's also one that would be the index story, right?
Oh, I think FANG's back alive. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, you do?
I do.
See, that's funny because some people are a little worried about Facebook, but you think FANG for the long term is probably a good play?
I mean, depending on what the long term is, I think.
Well, what is the long term? You tell us.
For me, long term is maybe 5 to 10 years. I don't know if the FANG trade is the trade, but I think here in the short term, I just think, again, because FANG is hot, or it's done well, money managers have to keep up with the index, that you're going to still see that become a crowded trade. And then retail investors like to buy those stocks on their own.
So when you look at what you're doing, Ryan, you're using some metrics that you just look at closely. You look at things like the bond yields. You look at the U.S. economy and some of the indicators within the economy. And when you're looking at those numbers, that's bringing you to your optimistic outlook, regardless of the trade story, right?
Yeah, exactly, right? Because the trade story, in my mind, is a little bit more like noise. I mean, if you look at the total tariffs right now, I think it's around like $68 to $70 billion that are intact at the moment. And we have an $80 trillion global economy. We're talking about, you know, drop in the bucket here, Nicole, when you're thinking about, you know, what this trade war means in terms of the entire global, you know, GDP right now.
So anything you would stay away from? I mean, whether it's a country, whether it's a type of investment or a sector?
Ooh. I think right now a really dangerous place to be are any sort of kind of high yield bond fund, any kind of bond fund in general, because you just mentioned rates have come down so low.
Yes.
Yes. And we had so much money jammed into these bond funds. So God forbid we get this trade war figured out and all of a sudden the global economy picks up. Interest rates go up and it's like a seesaw. When interest rates go up, bond prices go down. So if you're in a bond fund, you're trapped. You're going to see that depreciate. And it's not like you have a maturity date if you owned your bond outright.
Right. I mean, what do you think about people who use a lot of options along with their equity trade, sort of like, you know, the hedging way?
I think you're better to go to Atlantic City because they give you free drinks. I think options is always a risky game.
Oh, you do? You do? That's interesting. When did you decide that?
I decided that when I saw that you could buy an option, it can go to zero. And it's kind of like betting on red at the casino, if we had to be real about it.
Oh, that's interesting. That's interesting. So the big picture here of what we're looking at going forward, I mean, we've already had, we said the selling that we've seen in the last few weeks, right? For the Dow, it's 5 weeks, and we haven't seen that since 2011. But your projections from now to the end of the year, I mean, when we see the S&P 500 right now, you know, sitting at 28.27.
Yes.
Where do you think we're going by the end of the year?
I mean, S&P 3000. Where else are we going to go? The economy's strong. You know, employment is, we have unemployment at 50-year low right now. You have wages going up. And you have a more disciplined consumer, I would argue. You know, people are not spending like they did right before the crash back in 2008.
Right. Oh, that's interesting. You feel like consumer confidence is still there, though, to keep things going?
I do, because I think the consumer right now is doing well. I mean, if you're an average American, you're making more money, had a tax break last year, and you're still scarred from what happened when the global crisis hit back in 2000, you know, about a decade ago, right. You're seeing that, you know, saving levels are up and indebtedness is gone down from where it was like the mid-90s. So, you know, people are just more conservative than they were back in the day.